In this video, I'm talking to Dan Gommel from UNYBRANDS about how Amazon sellers could overcome different supply chain management challenges by learning what are the possible supply chain disruptions that can happen and thinking about how to work through such issues in advance. Dan explains why demand forecasting is so important, based on which data you as a seller should make decisions about your inventory, and how you could deal with some of the bigger shocks as well as adapt to smaller changes that happen over time. To learn more about UNYBRANDS, which is a company that buys Amazon FBA businesses and builds them into world-class consumer brands, you can click on the links in the description. Enjoy our conversation, and if you like this content, then don't forget to like this video and also subscribe to Orange Klik YouTube channel. Hello, Dan. I'm really happy to have you here on Orange Klik channel today to talk about some of the supply chain management challenges Amazon sellers can face. So before we go into the topic, could you please introduce yourself? Tell us a little bit about your background and also tell us what UNYBRANDS does.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you, of course, LISETT, for having me today and for this opportunity to talk about supply chain. So a little bit about my background. So I am the director of our European supply chain at UNYBRANDS. Before I was here, I spent a few years in e-commerce in the home goods category, working in transportation and focused on final mile. And before that, I spent much of my career in the automotive industry, actually working on global supply chain challenges, both strategic network design and inventory management and other topics that fit very nicely into some of the challenges that e-commerce retailers face. So that's in a nutshell, that's really my background. My responsibilities at UNYBRANDS are to get our goods from suppliers across the world to our retail markets in Europe, including the UK. So it's that end-to-end responsibility, end-to-end scope. And if I had to put it into a single metric, I would say that my job is to avoid out of stock, the dreaded outcome of supply chain. So in a nutshell, that's me. UNYBRANDS is one of the leading aggregators in the e-commerce space. We were founded, a year and a half ago. I've lost track of time already, and it's been an exciting run for us. We've acquired a number of brands, both in Europe and in North America. We've grown our team to over 100 people. A wild statistic I've read just today, 11 languages are spoken within our team. So truly global, and I've worked with really exciting brands and really smart, savvy founders to learn about their business and help grow it and expand it. And it's been a lot of fun and a good experience.
Okay, thank you very much for this introduction. Now we know for sure that you are the right person to talk about supply chain issues, which is definitely something we have heard a lot during the past year and we'll hear more about. So I know you have prepared some slides for us as well. So go ahead, share your screen and let's see what you have for us.
Yeah, okay, wonderful. So thank you, LISETT. As you mentioned, I have a few slides prepared. Really about managing challenges. You know, I think for many people, especially growth-oriented companies, especially many sellers in the e-commerce community, supply chain gets to the top of mind and starts to take a big part of the day, when it's time to manage challenges. So what I'd like to go through today is some perspective on how to manage challenges. What are the types of challenges, and just a little bit more of a strategic view on how to think about this part of your business. And at the end, I'll also share some specific examples of challenges that we've worked through with our brands. I hope that helps give some sellers some ideas, right, for when they face the inevitable. So speaking of the inevitable, this picture here became famous last year. So this is a photograph of the Suez Canal with a boat wedged right in the middle of it, the Ever Given. So the Ever Given is a massive container ship. After all the challenges with COVID and disrupted supply chains across the world, then this happened. And as I said, this photo, I think everybody's seen at this point, and I think is going to be a part of supply chain presentations for years and years to come, because it captures so visually and clearly how simple events can cause massive problems. And in this photo, just captures it so easy to see how this is a problem. The Suez Canal that this boat is going through is big. It's a huge part of global trade. I've read a statistic, something around 12% of global trade goes through this canal. So it's absolutely vital to keeping things moving across the globe. But while this picture is so simple and clear about how a disruption can happen in supply chain, I think it's really this picture right next to it that helps explain and helps show how that event in one point on our globe can cascade throughout. So here you can see a map of container ships and vessel movements in the Red Sea and in the Mediterranean Sea. And with that Ever Given stuck right there in the choke point, movements on both sides of the channel were disrupted. And of course, all of these boats were expected to be somewhere else in the future, and all of those transportations got disrupted. So it's a little bit like you're going on holiday and you're catching your flight connection through Frankfurt, and you know the plane that's going to take you to Mallorca is stuck in Zurich because of bad weather there, right? It's a little bit how those kinds of things can cascade through, and how bad weather in Zurich can delay your trip from Frankfurt to Mallorca. That kind of thing happens at a massive scale in the interconnected global supply chains. These things happen every day in supply chains around the world. There are disruptions, fortunately not all as major as the Ever Given, but they have happened before and they will continue to happen in the future. They're an unavoidable part of operating a business in global trade. Disruptions will happen to supply chain. We don't always know when, we don't always know where or how, just that they will happen. So what I'd like to talk to you about today are really five sections, right? So the first is to talk about maybe sort of starting to bring challenges into some context, right? A few questions to ask yourself when you're facing a challenge, to both understand your business, and understand the nature of the challenge itself. I'll talk a little bit about how we separate these into two big categories. In the second section, we'll talk about shocks or one-time severe events. In section three, we'll talk about little changes that happen over time and how to manage those challenges. In section four, we'll talk a little bit about how UNYBRANDS deals with this, because just like all of you, we are managing challenges in our supply chains every day. And then in number five, I'll share three specific examples to help bring a little more color to all of this. So for the first one about understanding a challenge, this is really where it begins. Right now, today, before you're hopefully not dealing with a challenge in your supply chain right now, is the perfect time to start reflecting on what is your strategic context for your business. This is kind of fuzzy language, but really what I mean here with this is, before you know how to solve a problem, you need to know the context of the business that this challenge is happening in. And I don't mean specifically your operations or your supply chain context, but really starting with first your customers. Who are your customers? What kind of demand do you face from your customers? Do you have forecasts detailed at a product level to understand what is this strategic context for your business? Start there. Don't focus first on the problem, but start really thinking about who are you serving your customer. This customer first mentality is important. And then work backwards towards your operations and consider things about your products, right? Related to customers, do you have seasonal demand for your products? Do you have shelf life concern for your products? These sorts of things start leading you towards different types of responses or levers to pull to try to manage challenges. Also think about your suppliers, not just your product suppliers, but also your suppliers if you have a third-party logistics provider or a transportation provider. Think about the context that you have with them, those types of relationships. Are they strategic partners? Are they transactional counterparties? These are different things to understand, help you understand what your options are and how to manage situations. And of course, also think about your financial situation, right? Do you have capital constraints? Where are those capital constraints? How does this work Understanding those is all about then finally getting to your operations and understanding your capabilities. And just by going through this exercise, you'll start to reveal certain types of avenues or certain paths to manage a challenge just aren't a fit or are a fit. Next, and this is actually a really important thing, I think, from a management perspective, is you really need to really understand your specific problem at scale, right? Or specific problem at hand, right? So we talked before, you've got the strategic context, understanding your business. Now it's, okay, let's really understand this problem, right? Does my business face a flow problem? The Ever Given is a great example of a flow problem. Goods just aren't flowing through the canal. Do you have a scaling problem? Meaning you have a supply chain that works for one product, but you need it to work for 100. You've successfully entered one country in the EU, but now you want to enter all the others. Or are you facing an efficiency problem, right? Where you have flow, you have scale, but you're not as cost efficient or service efficient as you want to be, right? It's really important to start breaking down and classifying the type of problem you have, because it helps you get to, helps illuminate and helps you find answers, find solutions. And then the last point here, I've stolen a quote from the famous author Hemingway, describing problems happen gradually and then suddenly. This is now, I think, a really important distinction to make as a manager and thinking about not just firefighting, but managing strategically your business and your supply chain. There's shocks, things that happen suddenly, quickly, overnight, something has changed, right? This is the suddenly part of the quote. And then there are things that evolve over time in the markets that we operate in. These are things that tend to happen gradually. The way you manage them, the way you react to them, and the way you deal with them have to be different because they are different. And I dwell on this point because our experience is that many sellers struggle to manage the gradually in supply chain and instead are left dealing with the suddenly. And this isn't a fun position to be in, but it's important to understand and think about and reflect on what is the type of challenge that you're dealing with and which category are you in? Are you in a gradual problem or a sudden problem? As I mentioned, I think that many sellers find themselves in the sudden problems first. So I'll talk about those. I'll talk about those to begin with. Another phrase to call these that's perhaps a little more intuitive is to say that this is like dealing with shocks, right? The overnight something changed about a fundamental belief or assumption that you have about your supply chain. You know, first, it's important to acknowledge it's hard to be anything other than reactive here, right? When something like this happens, it's happened. It's all about now reacting. And if you do this well, then this is what we call being decisive. So making decisions quickly and effectively to manage a situation. The things to focus on for turning these sudden events into decisive action is you need to have visibility and data. It doesn't need to be incredibly sophisticated, but you need to have some basic data and visibility to scope your problem. Understand how much of your business is affected by this. When will this affect your business? So gather data about scope and basic inputs to decision-making about costs or volumes or other characteristics. But data isn't everything. Especially when you have to move quickly, you're going to have to rely on judgment to fill in missing data. It's impossible to get every data point on everything you'd ever want to know. So ultimately, you're going to have to get comfortable filling in some of that missing data in order to make a decision. And there's also a third piece here, business savvy, right? So what else is connected in your business to the supply chain situation? And maybe a simple and an easy to understand example is you find out from your freight forwarder that your container was on the Ever Given and it is delayed. You need some business savvy to understand, okay, well, I have a certain amount of inventory and stock on hand already. Therefore, I am or am not facing an out of stock situation. And if you're facing out of stock, if you do nothing, then maybe you need some business savvy, some business judgment about making pricing changes or marketing changes or other levers to pull to manage the consequences of a shock. this is where a lot of people stop, right? They get through the crisis, they make a decision, and they move on to the next thing. But you know, to really manage your business and get it to the next level, you need to not let yourself be done with this shock or this surprise until you've considered strategic alternatives for your supply chain. This is when you take that hard look in the mirror and say, okay, maybe I need to operate differently in order to avoid this type of problem. You know, for situations like the Ever Given and for many shocks in a supply chain, there's no alternative really other than carrying more inventory. It's not a glamorous solution. It's not a slick or sophisticated solution. But sometimes there's just no replacement for having extra inventory in the market. But this is this requires capital investment, working capital investment that isn't necessarily something everyone has access to. So in those scenarios, you know, you also hear people talk about short supply chains, right? How can I make my supply chain short so it's faster, more responsive, more nimble? This can help. And there's a couple levers to pull here, right? You look at local suppliers. So rather than sourcing from overseas with long transit times, try to source in your country or at least in your continent to try to get to shorter transit times. Sometimes this helps, sometimes this doesn't. And there's also alternatives in transportation, right? So rather than going on a boat, you can put your products on a plane. It's a lot more expensive, but it's also a lot faster. And for some products and for some margin profiles, these economics do work. So it's ways to kind of start to tackle some strategic shortening of your supply chain. Also think about your partners in your supply chain. If you manage them as just transactional counterparties and you have no real persistent relationship, it's going to be harder to ask for favors. It's going to be harder to get prioritized. So you may have strategic decisions there about, you know, establishing more real and enduring partnerships with other folks. So in a nutshell, I think this is really about shocks, right? These are the things that happen suddenly. You have to embrace that you have to be reactive. And if you do this well, you're being decisive and you're using data to make business decisions and managing the consequences in other parts of your business. And to really manage this, you need to evaluate strategic alternatives, right? Are you operating your supply chain in the right fit for your business? So now I'd like to shift and talk about the gradually. This is where many shocks usually begin, is things that happen to our supply chain, our basic supply chain inputs, gradually and over time that influence how it should operate. Another way to think about this is just recognizing that your business and your supply chain operates in a dynamic market, a dynamic global market. You need to be adapting every day, every week, every month to that. Different from the suddenly, because If you try to manage the gradual changes in a reactive way, you're really just saying that you want to just deal with crises, right? It's basically a way of saying, I'm not going to worry about the small changes. I'm just going to worry about the big stuff. And then you're just dealing with the suddenly in supply chain and in supply chain challenges. So I'd really push folks to be thinking about how can they embrace trade-offs within their supply chain and how can they try to be proactive about managing these trade-offs. So how to do this? Okay, great. I'm going to be proactive. I'm going to embrace trade-offs. Where do you start? Well, right now, it starts with reading your contracts, reading your price rates or price sheets or your rate cards that you have with warehousing partners, logistics partners, understand your FBA fulfillment fees, really understand the costs that you have to pay, and understand how these connect to your current state operations. You'll quickly see that the way that you make decisions about how to operate leads you into different parts of rate cards, different parts of price sheets that affect your bottom line costs and expenses. So right now, read your contracts, understand how you operate today, and do the math to find when there's break-evens to change your operations. I'll talk more about that specific example or with a specific example later. And over time, once you understand your micro context with your contracts, then over time, then start building up a better knowledge of your macro market trends. So start thinking about what happens if sea container prices double or go in half, cut in half. How does that change the operational decisions that you would make? So to do this, of course, you need to understand your supply chain. Just like managing shocks, you need visibility and data to understand the scope of your business and basic inputs. You're still going to need judgment, and you're still going to need business savvy to do this well. I want to talk in this particular section about tools. So tools, and I'm using a vague term, but you know, software tools, anything that says we can solve your supply chain problems. You need to be careful with these. It isn't that they're wrong. It isn't that they're bad or that any of these software doesn't work. But if you're using tools and software to replace understanding, or you don't have good data going into them, you're just going to make more bad decisions or make bad decisions without understanding it. And you can gradually turn yourself into having a sudden problem. So tools help, right? They absolutely can help. But they complement, they do not replace understanding. There unfortunately is no alternative to just getting into the details and working through the problems. And when it gets to being proactive, even before you worry about tools or signing up for new software or anything like this, be proactive by looking at your metrics. There's a million management mantras about measure what you manage, or you can't manage what you don't measure. There's 100 ways to say it. But the basic idea here is measure your business, read your contracts so you know what things matter, and measure them every week, every day, every week, and review them so that you can take action and identify problems before there's a crisis, before it's a suddenly situation. And this really, really helps avoid many challenges, many fire alarms, and the stress, right, that's really turned supply chain off for a lot of people by getting ahead and being proactive. Next, I'll talk a little bit about how UNYBRANDS does this. So we have a unique perspective because we acquire brands. So we've seen many supply chains. You know, every brand we acquire comes with a supply chain. And this gives us an opportunity to see, you know, what are some of the common challenges or common themes. And I mentioned one of them earlier today was that we often see brands and we acquire them have gradually accumulated an operating situation that's vulnerable to a sudden change. It's not always clear to say it's been mismanaged or anything like that, but rather there's an accumulation of decisions, right, that then we need to make a strategic decision about, do we want to make operational changes to get to a different risk profile? This is a great opportunity for us. We've seen this many, many times. We get to decide when to make changes, and we have a capital and expertise to help execute changes and make this happen. This also gives us the opportunity to cross-pollinate, right? So the part of this happens when we bring in a new brand. We get to learn from all the brands that we've managed before and all the supply chains that our team has managed before UNYBRANDS. And it also gives us an opportunity when we have a brand gets impacted by some sort of market development in an extreme way or first, because then we get to quickly assess the situation and understand then and have a template to apply against all our other brands to evaluate where do we have common brands or common operating characteristics that would be affected by this. So that's really a great opportunity that we have. A big key to this is bringing these decision frameworks. These are things where I talked about this a little bit already, of where we're bringing on brands, we get to make strategic decisions, or we prioritize strategic decisions about how they operate, and make decisions then to get to different risk profiles, different capital profiles. And when we're operating brands, I already talked about this a little bit at the beginning, separating your challenges into flow versus scale versus efficiency. That's something we talk about every day, every week as a team when we're dealing with challenges. It's a very helpful framework to start to break down, you know, oh, I have a problem, into more specific context, more specific framing to help you get to solutions. We also, part of our decision framework is we also bring standardized and global KPI monitoring to all of our brands. So we measure key performance indicators or KPIs in our supply chains globally. And we're looking at this as a leadership team every week to identify trends, to know when there's when that gradually is happening, so we can avoid the suddenly, to bring it back to that framing again. And we also leverage, beyond from decision-making frameworks, we also leverage and standardize tools and processes across our brands. What we love about processes, what I love about processes, is that they create momentum. When you have a defined process for making a decision or managing a function or anything like this, it helps you bring momentum and performance improvement. So you can always know what your status is by measuring it. You can use processes and measurement to ensure compliance, to make sure you're following standards every time. And it's a great way to identify trends for the gradually, the early warning that something's happening in your supply chain that you can get ahead of. So in a nutshell, that's the UNYBRANDS approach. So what I'd love to now talk about is kind of three examples. The first part, so far we've been talking a little bit theoretical, a little bit more about management philosophy, but would love to give you kind of some specific examples. So I think everybody listening to this has some experience with the 2022 FBA fee fulfillment fee changes. This happened right at the end of Q1, beginning of Q2. And for some sellers with certain product profiles, this probably felt like a shock. We saw fulfillment, or not just we, but the fulfillment fee changes increased by, I think, up to 27-30% in that range for some products. And that's a really significant change. So for many suppliers, they saw their FBA fees go from this to this overnight. So this was something that Amazon notified sellers about in advance and provided transparency. So this gave us an opportunity to essentially take that data, take that insight, and measure our business at the product level. What many people quickly realized, not just UNYBRANDS, of course, is that the changes to these fees in Europe really increased costs and began to penalize especially high cubic volume and low weight products. So this is big and light stuff that folks sell. Smaller things, both in cubic volume, generally weren't as effective. So for support or as affected. So suppliers with those types of product profiles didn't see as significant an issue. But drilling into this a little bit more, we and many others saw that really the change here that Amazon was making was a change from unit weight or dead weight to more reliance on something in transportation that's called dimensional weight, or saying there's a standard weight for a cubic volume and applying that and charging sellers the greater of the two. This isn't unusual in the transportation industry. So for many folks have had experience with this, but it does open up different levers, different things to look at for how to manage these costs. So by kind of connecting all these dots and driving down to the product level, this gave us an opportunity to understand which products of ours were being affected and by how much. We could connect that to pricing strategy to know that how was our overall cost profile, end-to-end cost profile going to change, and how did that influence our pricing strategy. We also used it as an input to overall portfolio review for brands and using that as an input to identify if there are certain products that weren't economically viable anymore. And it even led us to explore some packaging changes. So really to take advantage of this change from two-dimensional weight from unit weight, let's look at some of our larger volume but lower weight products to explore some packaging changes to bring that cubic size down and adapt around the FBA fulfillment fee changes. So this is one that was felt like a shock for many suppliers, or excuse me, for many sellers, but really needs to be managed as one of those gradual changes, right? Transportation fees are probably only ever going up in our lifetime. Energy costs, which I'll talk about next, continue to go up. So this is something that you just need to understand and identify trade-offs and manage the business consequences. The second example, especially in Europe, was energy markets. So last year, this was already becoming a challenge. And then with the war between Russia and Ukraine, really just accelerated energy market costs. So many, not just e-commerce sellers, but everybody basically operating a global supply chain or international supply chain in Europe probably got some emails from their transportation partners announcing emergency fuel surcharges, increasing the cost of freight movements. We certainly saw these from multiple carriers in the European market. And, some folks called this a shock. For me, this wasn't a shock. This was, as long as I've been working in supply chain, there's been the debate around transportation costs, energy costs, recognition that it's always going to be going up with time and that this changes the way we need to manage things. So it needs to be managed accordingly, right? This isn't something that's a one-time deal that you need to address and then move on, but something that you really need to work on. So in our specific scenario, the type of proactive work that we did to try to manage this was that we have some freight lanes within Europe where we ship full truckloads, where we have significant volumes. The fuel surcharges makes these trucks more expensive. It's as simple as that. We're sending the same stuff from the same place to the same place. It's just costing us more money. So we tried to connect this to what are the day-to-day operational decisions that we're making. And specifically, we looked at how high we're stacking pallets. So the pallets that our supplier or manufacturer is putting onto the truck, we make a decision every time one of those pallets gets stacked as to how high, how tall to make it. The trade-off here was pretty intuitive. If the pallet is 1.2 meters high or less, then when that truck arrives at our warehouse, it can be taken off the truck with a fork and put on the shelf. Really easy, fast, efficient, and low cost put away at our warehouse. But when you're only stacking 1.2 meters high, you have to send more pallets. More pallets means more trucks. So the opportunity here is to move to stacking 2 meters high. So rather than just stacking 1.2, you can go up to 2.0, fewer trucks, saving transportation money. But when that pallet arrives at your warehouse, you can't just stick it in the shelf because the shelf is too low. So then our warehouse receiving has to basically receive and break bulk or turn that 2 meter pallet into 1.2 meter pallets. So this moves cost in the supply chain. So we had basically did the math. We looked at transportation costs. We looked at our put away costs and we made a business decision about where do we want to stack pallets into what height? For us, it was in this particular scenario, it was better to stack to 2 meters and move cost to the warehouse. But for every product profile, for every business, this math can be a little bit different because we have other lanes in Europe where sticking with the shorter pallet height actually is the better economic decision. So there's not a one size fits all, but those are some of the specific operational contexts or operational decisions you make every day that can have a big impact to how you manage the gradual and the sudden changes. And then my last one, my last specific example I have is gets to the concept of a short supply chain. So we acquired a brand that many larger brands pursue the same strategy of shipping high volume products directly from their manufacturer into Amazon. So this sounds great because it feels like you're doing both a short and a lean supply chain, which like that sounds awesome, right? But what happens when there's a surprise? What happens when there's a disruption? Short and lean in that scenario really means you're just very quickly out of stock. You have no backup, you have no buffer, and it's challenging to recover. So rather than make a broad-based decision of short and lean is good or short and lean is bad, we really modeled and did a strategic review of this brand to understand what is its product profile, its shipping costs, its unit economics, and use that to make a decision about when and why and how to change that network structure. And so this actually led us to implement a different network strategy for this brand to better manage our appetite for risk and better leveraging our supply chain, our existing supply chain partners and access to capital. So it helped us strategically change from a short supply chain to a little bit more of a hybrid that gives us a better risk profile in the right exposure for us as a supply chain, the better, better balance of trade-offs. I hope those three examples were interesting or kind of helpful for folks. You know, to tie it back to the beginning, roadblocks, challenges, these things are going to happen. This is every day for supply chain professionals. And it all starts with understanding what are the challenges that you have, breaking them down, turning them from ambiguous and terrifying problems into more segmented, more defined, more clearly scoped. And recognizing when you as a business leader are dealing with a shock, a surprise, a sudden change versus a gradual change. And defining the processes and the managerial approach to manage those differently, to move from managing the sudden changes to managing the gradual, as I talked through in some of our real examples. So I think that basically covers the content, LISETT, that I had prepared. I hope that was helpful for everyone. Do you have any questions that I might be able to help with?
Yeah, thank you so much, Dan. It was really interesting to listen to your presentation. And thanks also for bringing in some of the real life examples. I think it was really interesting to hear how you were kind of calculating yourself, how to be more efficient and also save more money with the supply chain. So that was really cool. So I think one of my first questions would be, generally speaking, are the supply chain challenges the same across different Amazon marketplaces? Or are there, let's say, any markets that stand out that have more specific kind of, challenges or anything that sellers should pay attention to?
Yeah, you know, this is, what a great question. So we have exposure to Amazon in North America, in the UK, and in the EU, which are managed as separate, separate markets for Amazon. I think one of the more interesting things that we're seeing is really around in between the UK and the EU. Of course, if I was doing this presentation a couple of years ago, the topic would have been Brexit, right? This was everybody in supply chain was working through Brexit. Everybody in Europe in supply chain was working through Brexit then. What's changed is that Amazon's has now re-enabled cross-border fulfillment. So allowing sellers operating in one, either the UK or the EU, to make that inventory available in the other market. This was much more common before before Brexit, but was stopped for 2 years, something like this. This is, I think, a really interesting opportunity. When you first read it, you think, this is great. I can flip a switch in Amazon and I am now executing international expansion. And there's a couple, kind of my feedback and guidance on this is kind of twofold. There's one is international expansion the right priority for your brand? Generally speaking, we see sellers are more successful and are more better rewarded when they're a really strong, really dominant local player rather than a mediocre or middle of the road global or international player. So before making the decision to expand internationally, because it brings lots of complexities, no matter how you do it, you really need to think strategically around what's your plan and vision for your brand, your operations, and your future, and is international expansion something you want to do, right? That's an important consideration before running into this. If you make the decision that international expansion is the right fit for you, then this cross-border fulfillment from Amazon creates new options. Essentially, what it means is you can keep your inventory in one market, right? So that's good for working capital. It's good for some operational simplicity, and make that available across the English channel. The drawback with this is that those movements, final mile movements to customers are more slow because they just have to go further. And even Amazon is subject to the laws of physics, and it's more expensive. So you will see this as an opportunity to expand into markets, but you'll be slow and you'll be more expensive. For some brands, this trade-off may be worth it, right? It's an opportunity to get your brand to a new consumer set, But you also need to be aware of this customer experience that folks are going to get. Again, I can't give a blanket one size fits all approach here, but I think that's something for folks who are looking at international expansion. That's an interesting topic to look at. Interesting new capability that Amazon is bringing.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much for that great reply. And to wrap up today's interview, I would ask, like, what's the number one thing you have seen so many sellers doing incorrectly while managing their supply chain overall?
I think I'll actually answer the question a little bit differently, Lisette. I think it's really, really important. You know, generally speaking, the successful brands, they make it work, right? And there's many, many, many ways to make a supply chain work. There isn't a single way. So the challenges that we tend to see are migrating supply chains from smaller teams, single person teams, small person teams, where the communication between people and coordination between the sales and marketing side and the supply chain side, is those frictions are like non-existent, right? Because sometimes it's all within the same person's head. And they know everything that's going on everywhere. So there's no information lag or any blind spots in decision-making. And when you move a brand to a larger scale environment where there's more people supporting it, if you just assume that you can operate without explicit communication and without, you know, those kind of structured processes, it can be bumpy and it can be rougher, right? So some of the things that we see is that, sellers need to prepare and be ready for the day that comes when their brand needs to get to that next level, when they can't all live inside their head. The investment needs to be in processes. The investment needs to be in tools. The investment needs to be in data to understand help team members communicate between each other. So that isn't really a shortcoming of sellers as they operate their brands today, because it isn't an issue. But it is a challenge that we see brands work through when they're scaling and growing to that next level, right? And that's a real hurdle, I think, for any seller, any business leader.
Okay, sounds really good. So again, thank you so much for joining me today. And before we go, could you once more explain what UNYBRANDS does and what kind of Amazon sellers should reach out to you?
Yeah, absolutely. So as I mentioned, we've acquired multiple brands. So we acquire both in Europe, continental Europe, and the UK, and we acquire in North America. We're targeting revenues in the $1 to $25 million dollar range. And we're looking within eight product verticals. The list of ones that we are strongest in are what we call juvenile and baby, garden, outdoor, sports and fitness, personal care, home care, pet care, and nutritional supplements. So these are the product categories where we're really strategically focused on. I hope that helps folks kind of figure out where they are. As I said, we bring a great team to this. As I mentioned before, we've got over 100 people across the globe. We have a couple teams in China focused on operations to help with many of the challenges, right, that folks are probably dealing with every day. So we have teams there. We have teams in Europe. We have teams in North America to be close to supply bases, partners, in order to make these things successful. I think in a nutshell, that's who UNYBRANDS is and who we're looking for.
Perfect. Thanks again for coming here today. And yeah, we wish good luck in overcoming those challenges you might face in the future.
Yes, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
I hope you enjoyed this video and learned what data do you need in order to better manage your inventory and how you could successfully overcome some more predictable and less predictable supply chain management challenges. From the video description, you will find information and contact details for UNYBRANDS. So if you're thinking about selling your Amazon business, check out their website and get in touch with them. And now I would like to invite you to watch another video we recorded with Ben Spatley from UNYBRANDS, where he explains how to launch Amazon FBA products by using sponsored ads to boost your new product sales velocity and ranking efforts.